Hello, everyone, and welcome to the SAG-AFTRA podcast. I'm Duncan Crabtree-Ireland, National Executive Director of SAG-AFTRA.
And I am Ben Whitehair, Executive Vice President of SAG-AFTRA.
Advertainment or branded content is going through a bit of a renaissance thanks to new technologies that enable creatives to tell stories in an entirely new way.
That's right. This new form of storytelling has attracted some of the biggest names in the business, including our guests today. Paul Feig is an Emmy-nominated filmmaker, writer, producer, author, and founder of Feigco Entertainment. Paul has directed comedy blockbusters such as Bridesmaids and The Heat. His most recent project, The School for Good and Evil, starring Charlize Theron and Kerry Washington, is yet another excellent project to take a look at.
Laura Fischer also joins us, who along with Paul is co-president of Feigco Entertainment. Laura oversees the company's feature slate, including the recently produced The School for Good and Evil. Laura is also CEO of Powder Keg, Feig's voice-driven content company that champions new voices with a commitment to female and LGBTQ creators and filmmakers of color.
Welcome to you both. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
So what is advertainment and how would you define it?
It's entertainment that gets paid for with ad dollars.
Other people pay for it.
We've talked a lot about story first, and it is entertainment first. And we've been really privileged to work with advertisers that see it that way. And so their ad presence is supportive and we're aligned and it doesn't really feel like it's, you know, offensive to the audience.
And that's what makes it more compelling is the fact that it's story first.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's always so jarring to watch a movie when product placement happens, you know, and then suddenly, you know, whoever the star is holds up, you know, the bottle with the label out. And it just audiences are just too savvy for that now. And you just kind of go, okay. So the thing about this is just, it's completely woven into the fabric of the storytelling.
Well, I love everything you all have said about the approach of storytelling and creativity first. I'm curious to hear for anybody listening a little bit of the backstory about the Mr. Right app and, you know, basically what is that and what led you to this really unique blend of sure advertising, but a unique way to tell a story.
Yeah, we see it as an opportunity to tell a story for sure. It's so nice of Verizon to have paid for it. It was a story that we had come up with when we had a slate at Echo, which was an interactive storytelling platform. Echo ended up shifting priorities during the pandemic, like so many online platforms. And so we took that story written, created, and directed by Diana Snyder, and we always wanted to make it. The idea was, could you make the perfect man if you had the opportunity in an interactive storytelling situation. And we thought it was so sticky. So when we came to Verizon, they were so interested in doing something that was entertaining, that was funny, that was comedic, and that was female driven. They weren't getting any of those sort of content plays coming across their plate. So we said, we have the perfect thing for you. They wanted to promote 5G. So we had to make the app out of the house so that you got out of Wi-Fi. And I was inspired by my own kids' obsession with Pokemon Go. And so as we're out in Glendale chasing all the Pokemons across the bridges and libraries of town, I thought, well, this would be so fun for adults. What about Pokemon Go for a woman? Like, what if we're tracking where you are and what you're doing and how those choices impact what you choose in our stories? So we sort of pitched as Pokemon Go for women with the central question of, could you create the perfect guy if you had the chance?
Pokemon Go?
Pokemon. Coming next
single,
year.
Single woman too.
Okay, Rob. Well, you tired me out. I'm going to sleep.
Good night, Sophia.
Well, do you want me to pull out the couch for you or? Oh, wait, let me guess. Robots don't sleep, do they?
Correct. I do not need rest, physical activity, or food.
Cool story. So what am I going to do with you all night? Oh, I know. I'm going to give you my phone. So while I'm sleeping, you're learning.
Paul, I'm curious, you have a really interesting take on the different types of content and how involved or not the audience is and when you let them be in charge and when they want to not be in charge. And I'd love to hear more about how you think about that as you've done all kinds of projects across that spectrum.
Yeah, I think all storytelling is different and audiences come to each project with a different expectation. And a lot of why we love entertainment is just, you just want to turn your brain off or just let your day be done and say, I'm just going to put my hands in the hands of a great storyteller and let them take me on a journey. And that's clearly not what the interactive is, but interactive fills another void of the gamer in people or just the people who want to be involved, who want to be able to change things up, who want to be surprised by things. of their own making. And so, you know, as long as you're clear about what the entertainment will bring to the people, whatever the person consuming it is, then that's, it's all valid. It just, you just have to know what people want. Like, you know, I wouldn't expect an audience coming in to just be put in the hands of a filmmaker to suddenly then be given choices. You're like, well, I don't want to choose right now. I want you to choose for me.
And then kind of why I bought the ticket.
Yeah, exactly. You know, but then if you go in and go like, oh, this is gonna be fun, I can really affect this, then that's great. And that scratches two inches, you know?
Yeah, we thought a lot about this in the development process of, you know, those BuzzFeed quizzes that sort of spit out who you are or who you are in a show or something like that, and how you want to just keep retaking them and you want to send them to your friends. And so we felt like if this question was, could you make the perfect guy? And the answer is probably no, 17 out of 18 times, then you might be interested in trying again and sharing it with your friends and be like, who did you get? So I think there's a bit of interactive where it's really fun when there's a mirror to it, you know, where you're sort of seeing yourself and it's telling you something about yourself. It's not just the burden of telling a story. It's actually giving you a bit of a reflection of yourself. We thought that was sticky.
Yeah. And the community element of that, right? And I think that's what's so interesting is that intersection of storytelling and the human communal nature with technology allowing us to do that in a different way.
And fun life lessons. Yeah, you can make the wrong choice. Yeah, so you learn, oh, I won't do that. I mean, maybe
kind of a jerk.
Maybe you'll get some out of it. Exactly. That's right, really. Don't build them.
Back to one.
Reset.
Is there a gay following for the app too? Because I would imagine that there's got to be, right?
So we hope that there will be. We actually have a pitch for a gay version of Mr. Right, and that, like, we wanted Mr. Right. First of all, we talked about if it was Mrs. Right too when we were first starting, but we felt like Mr. Right was a bit more inclusive in some ways. And we really, really want to be able to do the version that is LGBTQ because I think it's just ripe for the audience. Yeah. And I hope they let us do that.
I have a feeling it would be a hit. Yeah.
On that note, I'd love to hear more about what you all are doing. You know, you've done a lot to give opportunities to the BIPOC community, the LGBTQ community, female filmmakers, and this sort of untapped potential of these communities that haven't had opportunities. And I think you all have a really powerful approach to, as you have said in other places, like actually give those opportunities. But so I'd love to hear more about the impetus of that and where you see that moving in the future.
Well, I mean, we just are tired of hearing the same voices all the time, and that we know so many talented people who don't get a chance to put their voices out there. You know, and I've been able to mentor a lot of people in my career, but mentoring is like only goes so far because you're kind of teaching them how to fish, but then you don't give a fishing pole at the same time. You know, so what I like about this is we're creating the opportunity so that they can create a calling card that they can put out there. We can then, through the process, see if they're good at it. So then we are able to, without any hesitation, advocate for them. And so it just makes it, you know, then we are creating opportunity.
I think Paul was a visionary from a very early stage before Me Too, before all of this happened, when we started conceiving of Powder Keg. He was saying the new next voices are the ones that are going to be funny in tomorrow. And it's not just me making the same joke. It's whoever comes in over the top of me and rewrites it in today's voice. And I feel like that was so visionary and so humbling at the same time. And it empowered us to be able to go find those voices. So every person we work with has a very clear voice. But our motto, and this is just us as producers, we do it. We want to see something they've made. We want to make it with them. And we want to actually have that product, whether it's a short film or an interactive series for Snapchat or an interactive story for Verizon or some sort of scripted dramatic podcast. I mean, we just want to make something and see how it is. We get a lot of calls from studios from those filmmakers up for a next big project. And it's the biggest thrill of our day to be able to say yes. They can absolutely do it. You are going to love them.
You know, and even where a voice comes through in a script, it never comes through fully until it's actually been shot, you know, and executed. And so that's what's so exciting to even see scripts. We go, oh, that's really fun. And then the final product, and you're like, that's even cooler than I thought it was going to be, or that's funnier, or that's weirder than I thought, in a great way.
Yeah. And helping them find that voice through the process, too. We always have said from the beginning of the company that our job and our value as producers is to help you make choices. And I think when you see a really clear voice, there's still a thousand things that can go wrong before it comes out, and really helping them come up with the right choice, how to edit, how to choose those moments, which joke to pick, to really get focused. And it's a thrill to see it come together.
And how to problem solve. I mean, you know, that's movie making is literally 90% problem solving, I hate to say. All the stuff with the director standing in front of the camera, holding his hands up, just composing a shot, that's like about 5% of the job. Yeah. That's the fun part. Everything else is staring at your watch. I always tell film students, like, get a nice watch because you can be staring at it all day long.
Oh, gosh. Well, speaking of the fun part, Paul, you've said in an interview that it was Las Vegas, where we are right now recording this podcast, mm-hmm. that inspired your fascination and love of martinis.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, yeah. When I was very young, I was five, six, seven. I don't know. I got brought to Vegas by my parents, who were going to see a Muhammad Ali fight, and they put me into the nursery, which at the time was on the casino floor.
That can't be legal anymore.
Is that just a slot machine?
Like, I know, exactly.
Here's some tokens.
It was like a room with a sliding glass door, and it was on the side of the casino, and you could stand against the and watch people gambling. And I saw all these adults dressed nice, and they're drinking martinis and all that. And I was just like, I want to be that. I don't want to be in here with these dumb kids. And it's never left me.
Wow, and maybe this makes this podcast into advertainment, but we've also been told that you have your own gin.
I do. Ardingstall's Brilliant London Dry Gin. Go to ardingstallsgin.com to find out where you can get it. Always selling.
How did that happen? I mean, how does one have a gin company?
I've been a gin fanatic for 25 plus years, and always went, like, if I can make my own, I know how I want to make it taste. It'd be different than anything else anybody ever had. And then I finally, about 7 years ago, hooked up with a company called Minhas out of Calgary, but we actually distill it in Wisconsin. And it's a thrill to have that. It's a nice sideline.
It's the only gin I like.
Ah, there you go. Thank you. Well done.
I'll definitely have to try it. So
yes, I'll be pouring them soon.
Well, I do. To me, I think it's just very interesting, like, how many different elements of multiple industries all can intersect through storytelling, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's, you know, we've talked about different companies and different types of telling stories, and I think being here at CES and you know, SAG-AFTRA has had a presence here for the last 20 years, and the new technology that allows brands to interact in different ways, that allows storytellers, people who haven't had perhaps access to tell their stories, and it's becoming easier and less expensive to do that yourself. And then I think what I love hearing both with, you know, Mr. Wright and the other examples that you all have, is that I feel like those worlds are continuing to collide in really wonderful ways that create a lot of opportunities. And for me, it does keep coming back to what you both have said of, like, the storytelling and having a voice and an opinion matters. And I think for my fellow actors listening, I think that is very helpful to hear, because I think it's easy for people to hear, like, well, it's just about the money and it only this and that, and you just have to be what the producers want. And what I hear you all saying is, like, no, it's about having an opinion and a voice and an experience and a story. And I think that that's really heartening to hear from people who've had the level of success, you know, that are theoretically on the other side of the table from us, how important that is.
Well, I would say, actors, don't sit around waiting for the phone to ring. Don't wait for auditions to come in. Create content, you know, whether you're going to go do stand-up, whether you're going to join an improv company, whether you're going to start making videos on your phone that'll look fantastic because you can shoot in HD now. Like, create the opportunity for yourself. Put it up so people can see you, because the days of the phone ringing and getting auditions, you know, that's a, you know, I was an actor for a long time, 15 years I was a professional actor, and those were the worst times when I wasn't proactive. And when I was proactive, I would get seen.
I think a lot of our influencer members are really, you know, taking that advice to heart,
totally.
Because combining, and it really connects, I guess, in a way to advertainment, because combining relationships they may have with brands or with funding that they may get from brands to create something that's not purely a commercial or just an endorsement video, but something that has a funny twist to it, or, you know.
The brands are opportunities these days.
Yeah.
We're so lucky that Sam Asghari, who stars in Mr. Right, saw it that way. Mm. It was a tough job to go, okay, you're going to be a robot who is becoming human, and there's 17 endings. And he just embraced it and said, what a great opportunity. And he saw it, as I hope a lot of actors do, as an opportunity to create and collaborate with a filmmaker on something really innovative. And he saw a personal upside for that creative opportunity. And we love playing with people like that. Because
exactly.
These filmmakers are people that they'll continue to work with for years and years. We love to put together teams for the first time and watch them continue to make movies and films and TV shows together.
And it's great for actors to work with new filmmakers, you know, because that, you know, it becomes Scorsese and De Niro. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Work begets work.
Yep. Exactly.
And I just really love that balance of, hey, there's all these new opportunities and there's different ways to tell stories. And I, you know, certainly being passionate about SAG-AFTRA and the union, and that, like, yes, there are protections and we need to be mindful of the downsides. But again, I think you all and, you know, your continued work with SAG-AFTRA and the approach of, like, hey, there's a win-win here and the brand can be happy. Actors get to have this, like, amazing way to tell a new story. You get to work with new storytellers, and that I think entertainment has a lot to teach the tech and other industries of, hey, we can all work together and it can come out really well for everyone.
Yeah, and kudos to SAG-AFTRA for always working to help us do this kind of thing, because everything is different. The parameters are different, but you know, they understand that the most important thing is for actors to work and then to obviously be compensated.
We have to give a shout out to Kylie, who's in the room, who has taken my call year after year for 6 years of this innovative company going, I have a thing. It's not normal. It's short form interactive. It's vertical. It's on Snapchat. It's not on a platform we've ever worked on before, and just always rolling with us and being able to say, okay, we can cover you, we'll figure it out, sure, you know, just starting the conversation early.
What a great example from the, you know, producer creative side of, again, it sometimes takes many years to figure out, and like, you continue to grow and build and look at, you know, what all that's turned into. That's really exciting.
And to find paths for new things. Mm-hmm. Things none of us have seen before.
Oh, no, totally.
We all want to be working and exploring and creating. And if brands help us do it, we are here for it.
Yep. Amen to that.
Well, Paul Feig, Laura Fischer, thank you so much for being part of the SAG-AFTRA podcast with us.
Thank you. What
a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Viva Las Vegas, everyone.
Get yourself a martini.
Martini time.
Martini sauce, Jen.
The SAG-AFTRA podcast is produced and edited by Aaron Goddard and John Small. Supervising producers are Pamela Greenwalt, Shira Reich, and Michael McNulty, with production and marketing support from Damon Romine, Jalika Conte, Margot Giordano, Bernadine Robbins, and Maria Cabezas. This podcast is hosted by Ben Whitehair and me, yours truly, Duncan Crabtree Ireland.
For more information and resources from today's episode, please visit sagaftra.org/podcast. And if you gained any value from today's podcast, please consider sharing it with someone else who might find value. If you haven't already, please tap that subscribe button and take a few seconds to rate and review this episode. And please follow SAG-AFTRA on our official social media channels. That's @SAG-AFTRA on all major platforms, including YouTube.